Today on Behind the Graph, we are looking at the graph of Katherine Johnson, sent in to us by Esther. Now, one of the best ways to learn about Desmos is by really digging into a beautiful graph like this one, which has so many neat components, a really natural chalkboard effect, a wide variety of mathematical functions, and such attention to detail. Today, we are focusing on one of the smallest of those details, a single shoe. Now, before we start creating, I want to make sure to find the custom colors Esther used, which are defined by these different HSV values. Now, when we focus in on just the back heel portion, there's still some long, intimidating equations here. So we're going to just grab one of these and copy it down so we can dig in a little bit deeper. First thing, I'm going to peel off these restrictions represented by the curly brackets at the end and focus on the function being graphed. Now, this is quite the function, fractions and absolute value symbols, but let's notice some patterns. This 47.15 value, for example, shows up twice right next to the x variable, so we can determine that's controlling where this function is side to side, its horizontal position. And now, one by one, I can learn a lot just by adjusting each one of these different numbers and seeing how they are each impacting the graph, and then get that visualization just right for the object that I'm trying to model. Seeing these vertical bars, which represent an absolute value function right at the end, which if you've seen them before, you might recall they often give a V-shaped graph. So that is what's giving the slant on either side at just the right angle to get the desired effect. Now that my function is just right, we're going to want to use this same function multiple times, and I don't want to risk messing up all these values we just carefully picked. So this is a great opportunity to give this function a name, which also helps me organize my equations by naming it after the sides of the heel that it represents. Now by using this new name and an inequality, I can shade the region above these curves. Now to start restricting this to get that heel shape, I first want to have a flat horizontal line at the bottom. Now with a single y inequality inside some curly brackets after my equation, I'm restricting the shading to only values above that line. Now to get the curved edge along the top, Esther brought in a new function, which represents the ellipse or oval shape. Again, we can adjust these values and see how the shape transforms and get that curve just right. Once we're happy with the function to represent the top edge of that heel, we can give it a name. Now notice how this function has both x's and y's in it. So we have to define our function in terms of both of those variables. But now we can still restrict my initial shading to only the portion that's inside of that ellipse shape using those curly brackets at the end. Now that we've established our mathematical functions, now we can add some realism and shading by adjusting some line settings. So we can create a nice black outline, as well as set the fill opacity of our shaded region to 1, which gives a solid opaque appearance. Now we want to introduce a gradual shading effect. To accomplish this, we actually repeat the same function with some slight adjustments to the restrictions at the end. Instead of shading all the way down to the bottom, we want to raise that lower bound up. However, we still want it to be bounded at the top by the same curved edge. And then we can change the color to black and give it a nearly transparent fill. So that's our strategy, but now we can just repeat that same function, but just keep raising that lower bound in the restriction. By doing this multiple times, that stair-stepping function gives it that gradual fill effect. And for each of these, we keep setting the color black, and we're gonna keep gradually increasing that fill setting, going from 0.08 to 0.1 to 0.15 and so on. Now all that gives that nice shadow effect. The last piece we need is just a solid heel at the bottom of this piece. So we're still going to keep that same inequalities, but now we're going to bound it with a horizontal line on the top and the bottom and set a fill opacity to 1 to give that solid block at the bottom. And there you have it. So many clever strategies and techniques in this tiniest of details. Thanks again to Esther for the inspiration for sharing her amazing graph of Katherine Johnson. What should we look at next time when we go behind the graph?